Recording, there we go. Now we're officially back. So, welcome folks. Thanks for being here. We are talking about logits and odds and all that fun stuff. So this is the page that I'm on for odds ratios in particular, but I want to back up a little bit. What's a logit? And I'll put up a picture to help you. There we go. What is a logit? The one thing you gotta know for all of this to make sense. We see the presenter format of the slides. What does that mean? Oh, what's coming next? I don't see that. That's interesting. Hang on. How's that? Better? Okay, excellent. Thank you. All the different settings. There we go. So what is a logit? Who wants to tell me? Or nominate one of your friends to tell me. Your choice.
Yeah, I can start with the stuff that I know and understood. It's like the log of a ratio. And I think what this picture was supposed to tell us was that it's shifting. The probability should range between 0 and 1, and the logit is helping us to shift it to a wider scale.
Yes, very good. Yeah, the purpose of a logit is to create a conditional mean to be predicted by the model that is unbounded. That way there's no worries about it going too high or too low as a function of the predictors. But then when you unlogit it back down to probability, called inverse link, then the probabilities stay bounded between 0 and 1. And the same idea is used in a log link for outcomes in which there's a lower boundary at 0, but there's not an upper boundary. So logit reels in both sides to have boundaries, and log only reels in the one side. Yes, so that's one important thing, logits. What about their cousin probit? Remember what probits are? Same idea, different scale. Oh, that one's rustier. Probit's a z-score. It's the z-score that goes with that probability as the area to the left under the cumulative normal distribution. So it does the same thing, but it's in a z-metric, which means it has an underlying standard deviation of 1, variance of 1, whereas logit has an underlying variance of 3.29, which comes from the logistic distribution. So you'll see those numbers pop up today. Good. So we talked about what happens when we put binary outcomes into a multi-level model. What are some of the complications that you remember? There's a few that I can think of. What about variance explained at level 1? Can we do pseudo R square for level 1 in a multi-level model on a binary outcome?
Yeah, I think it's complicated because the E residual, it's not, it's only limited to two expressions. And so we don't really have the usual variance that's not, should be normally distributed.
Yeah, so because we're not assuming a normal distribution, there's no separately estimated variance at level 1. It's always going to be 3.29 if you're using a logit link, and it's always going to be 1 if you're using a probit link. So that means that anytime you would have explained level 1 variance, the rest of the model has to change scale to reflect what the parameters would be if there was a larger total amount of variance before adding in the predictors. So while we can do things like pseudo R-square variance explained for random effect variances at level 2 and higher, we cannot do pseudo R-square directly for level 1 explained variance. We have to do some other way of indexing effect size like an odds ratio. So yeah, when we write the expressions for the level 1 model in a single level model, or let me fast forward here to the two level model. Let's get through some of that stuff. We don't need that today. In the two-level model, it's the same deal. The level one expression, if you write it in hierarchical form, doesn't have an e. And that's not because it's perfect, it's because e represents the idea that we have a separately estimated and constant residual variance, which we don't have. So that's one thing. Another thing has to do with the interpretation of the fixed effects here. So these are what are known as unit specific, meaning that it's not just that the fixed intercept in this case is the mean of the person means. It is also conditional specific to a person who has a random intercept of zero. So it's not going to be the exact mean. I think it works out to be something like the median in binary data, but that doesn't necessarily hold more generally. So you will see the fixed effects wiggle around more after you add a corresponding random effect because they mean something different, and we'll see that in the example today. What about estimation? Is it easy and fast or hard and not fast? Make this a multiple choice question. It takes time, yes. And this is one of those topics that could be an entire workshop in and of itself. But just I can say briefly the reason that it takes time is if you're using full information maximum likelihood, which is what we which is the preferred method if you have the capacity to do so, then you're working with a conditional distribution at level one that's not normal, like binomial or Bernoulli or multinomial or something like that, paired with random effects that are supposed to be normally distributed, multivariate normal. And there's no easy, like, closed form way to put those two distributions together into some kind of expected structure. I once had some students try to name what that would be called, though. They came up with either Normuli or Bernormal for what it would be if you took a binary distribution and a normal distribution. I like Bernormal personally, but unfortunately, that is not a real thing. So, what has to happen is some way of integrating or filling in the random effects as the likelihood function tries to figure out what is tallest. It essentially tries out different values for what the random effects would be per person, and each dimension then exponentially increases the number of tries that it takes. So for instance, in M plus, the default number of tries is 15. That's called quadrature points. And if you had two random effects, it'd be 15 by 15, so 225 tries at each step. And so that process takes more time. There's no easy way, no easy fast way to do it. And that's where Bayesian estimation starts to shine in particular, is when in situations in which likelihoods start to bog down. So the short answer is these models take longer and they're trickier to estimate. That's the other complicating factor. All right, I think that's the big stuff I wanted to review. What am I forgetting? There, we landed on this one. Anything that I'm forgetting that you want to talk about or hear more about from last time? You can use the chat too. You can send me a direct message if you don't want to talk or don't have your microphone available. No, we're feeling okay? Okay. So, just to put a plug out there, and by the way, I've got my notes from last time, my little paper I've been scribbling on, as to topics that I can send you more resources about. So, don't be shy if you're asking, if you're like, do you have anything about this, or can you talk about this? I can try to find something for you about whatever this is. But this is a plug for all other kinds of not normal outcomes that the generalized linear modeling family has built-in ways of addressing. So, we talked about binary last time, which is a combination of usually a logit link function or probit, plus Bernoulli as the type of distribution that you're saying the level one outcome has. Ordinal or nominal works pretty much the same way, except the logit link function has to divide multiple categories into binary submodels, and how that happens determines whether your model is ordinal or nominal. But either way, it's paired with a multinomial distribution, which is just more than two categories. If you're modeling proportions, things like accuracy rates or rates of injurious behavior out of some fixed amount of time, something like that. That is another situation in which logits would be helpful because proportions are bounded between 0 and 1, the same as a probability of a 1 would be, so it's the same idea. The only catch is because proportions are continuous between 0 and 1, we need some other kind of distribution. And usually it's something in the binomial family. Beta binomial in particular handles overdispersion. That one is harder to find in a multi-level setting, but you can find it fairly readily for single-level models. The world of counts, of course, so discrete whole numbers bounded at 0 or bounded at 1 in some cases. That's what a log link function would be for. And then some kind of count distribution, Poisson or negative binomial family. There's also zero inflated or hurdle variance where they divide up the zeros into a second outcome. Censored data, when it looks like something is sort of cut off because of measurement limitations, that has a link function called Tobit, which is something I'm still struggling to understand. So if anyone has any resources for me on how to interpret a Tobit link function, I would love to hear them. That one is usually paired with a normal distribution, or also Bernoulli distribution for whether or not an outcome is censored. Skewed continuous outcomes can be handled with a log usually, or a log normal or gamma. One of you mentioned in your questions in the survey that I sent out that you had an outcome that ranged from negative infinity up to zero, and it was fairly skewed towards zero, if I remember correctly. The only way that I know how to do something like that would be to reverse it. So then it ranges from zero to positive infinity. And then in that case, you can make use of these models. The only catch is that log normal and gamma as distributions don't have zeros. So if you do have zeros, you would need to add on a hurdle type component where you would predict whether it's zero or not as one outcome, and then simultaneously what the score is if not zero. So those are called two-part models. They're called hurdle models. I call them if and how much because that's what the two submodels mean. If you have a presence of something, if not zero, and then how much, if not zero. There's probably others that I'm not even aware of, but these are the ones that I see most commonly for that. If you have a bimodal distribution, beta is flexible for that, but it's bounded between zero and one, so you can't have zeros and ones without adding an extra submodel. And then, yeah, zero inflated, either a logit or a log. And then Bernoulli or other given each part of the distribution. So there's a lot of choices here. There's a lot of that are built into software, and there's probably even more that I can't include here, but this is sort of the bigger picture. These would be the keywords that I would search for if you're looking for something to handle a particular kind of outcome. So, any questions or thoughts on that? Coffee, reload.
Yes.
I heard a voice. Okay, that voice wasn't talking to me, just as well. You all heard a voice too. I'm not crazy, right? Okay, just making sure.
Sorry, it might have been me. I was testing my microphone because Zoom told me to do so. Yeah.
It's no problem, no problem whatsoever. One of the funnier instances of this is when I overheard one of my students picking up their kids from school. She was on Zoom in her car and was asking him how their day was and if they wanted a snack. And I was just like, okay, when she got to, do you want a snack? I'm pretty sure that was not meant for me, so I'll just go ahead and mute her. But it's kind of funny what other conversations you can have. I also have students who figured out how to be in two Zoom classes at the same time, which is a skill I have not figured out in Zoom. And so occasionally they'll unmute themselves in the wrong room and answer the question from the other class in my class. And I have to listen for about 15 seconds before I realize whether or not it's at all relevant to what we're talking about. It's like, oh, nope, that's the other class. Mute you too. So, Zoom fun. But no questions right now or things that you want to discuss further on this idea. Okay, then I'm going to change gears somewhat abruptly and ask you this question. Were any of you wondering why I asked you how familiar you were with IRT? In the context of a mixed effects modeling workshop, item response theory as a psychometric model. Did that strike you as strange? Or was it more expected? One vote for strange. How about we make it a thumb question, since lots of you have your cameras on today? Expected is thumbs up, strange is thumbs down, and you can have the full continuum of thumbness in between. Okay, so halfway to down seems to be the distribution here. So let me tell you why. The short answer is that random effects are latent variables. What I call a U as a random intercept, 2 slides from now, I'm going to call theta as the idea of latent person ability. So believe it or not, all psychometric models can be thought of as multi-level or mixed effects models at the same time. And understanding those connections allows you additional flexibility in thinking about how you can turn more traditional experimental cognitive or rating type tasks into some kind of instrument with which to measure individual differences. So I want to show you that connection and where the world of IRT distinguishes itself from the world of mixed models with respect to differences in discrimination. So backing up just a minute here, if we're thinking about moving from one outcome per person to multiple outcomes, that could be multiple occasions per person, multiple items per person. It could be multiple outcomes per person. So what we've been talking about is the idea of random effects. So they can be in longitudinal models or other kinds of repeated measures models, which is the specific focus here. And we might have, say, 4 occasions in which what we're trying to do is figure out how much of the variability across the 4 occasions in an outcome is because of differences between people. So this could be differences in mean levels. It could be differences in how people react to time-varying predictors or other kinds of predictors. And then how much of that is within persons. So after we control for all the reasons why people differ from each other, why is it that some occasions are higher than lower, or so why is it that some trials have responded to faster than others? At the same time, though, I could talk about this exact same scenario in a measurement context where we have item responses from a person. So you can think of those as trials as well. And what we're trying to figure out is how much of the variability in the item responses is due to what we'd call a latent factor. So this is the idea of between person differences in something that we can't directly observe, and it's only observable through the pattern of item response. In the same way that between person differences over time are only observable through the patterns of change over time or fluctuation over time. So, latent factor has a whole lot of synonyms. It's latent trait, latent variable, latent construct. It's called true score in the world of classical test theory. It's called theta in the world of item response theory. And it's called a factor score in the world of SEM or confirmatory factor models. But it's the same exact idea. And then whatever is not due to between person individual differences, we say is due to some other thing. So residual, unique variance, specific variance, whatever you want to call it just means not the factor. So in reality, these are the same thing. There's a direct mathematical equivalency here. The only question is what other features you can add into the model that you need due to your sampling design or your research questions. So, in one vein, we would talk about the world of random effects or multi-level models, mixed effects models, hierarchical linear models. All of those things are synonyms. And we would say that the purpose of those is to handle dependency. It's the idea that responses from the same sampling unit are correlated. So, we build in random effects that predict and account for those patterns of correlation. A random intercept means all observations from the same person are equally correlated. A random slope allows some kind of non-constant correlation as a function of a known predictor variable. So there's lots of sampling designs that would lend themselves to these sorts of models to address dependency and to be able to isolate different types of variability and predict them in turn. In the world of latent variables, so traits, factors, etc., then what we're trying to do is represent the idea of a pure source of individual differences that is more comprehensive and more reliable than what we would get from any one individual outcome or item response. So we talk about this using completely different notation for a different purpose, a different setting, and there's different words. So if you are assuming that your item responses are continuous and normally distributed, and you're adding latent variables to predict them, That is the world of confirmatory factor analysis or structural equation models. If you have categorical outcomes, so binary, ordinal, or nominal, and you're having latent variables predict those, then we would call that item response theory, IRT, or IFA is the term that I use in when I teach these models for item factor analysis. And here's a link to my class that I just finished in the spring that covers all of this stuff from the same sort of integrated perspective. But I think of these as exchangeable because they are, and they're mechanisms. They're mechanisms by which we can use complete data, we can avoid having to assume missing completely at random, and we can introduce and quantify and predict different kinds of variability. So then the question is, in these sorts of designs, when do you need to have a separate type of random effect for the items? So in the picture that I just showed, let me back up here. This would be the type of picture in which occasions are treated as nested within persons, or items are treated as nested within persons. But in the example that I showed you last time, let's see, a couple weeks ago now, items and persons were crossed, right? We had a random intercept for items, we had a random intercept for persons. So then the question is, how does this world interface with that? Well, items are clearly nested in persons in a few cases. One is in which the model fixed effects explain all of the differences between items. So this is what happens in your standard psychometric measurement model, either IRT or factor analysis. Each item has its own fixed properties relating to its difficulty and its discrimination. That means there's no more differences across items that you could possibly have in those ideas, and therefore no additional random effect needed. It's also true if you have a design in which there's only one item of one kind. So let's say that you're giving vignettes, and this is an example from a student I'm working with where she's interested in people's ability to detect ableism in an educational setting. So she has vignettes where there's various kinds of ableism, maybe there's four kinds, and then she had, let's say, three levels of obviousness, and she had one vignette that filled in each possible combination. So maybe 12 altogether. Well, if you put in all of the fixed effects that would say, is there a main effect of type of ableism? Is there a main effect of how obvious it is? And is there an interaction? And you treat those as the categorical predictors that they are. That fully saturates all the reasons why the vignettes would differ from each other, and you don't have to worry about having variants left over. There's only one of each kind. So once you put in the kind, you're done. It's the same idea as if you had, for people, a treatment and a control group, and once you put in who's in which group, you don't have to control for group anymore. It's done. It's that same idea. It's also the case that items would be nested if they're not the same across people. So I helped with a research study a long time ago where participants had to list like 10 memories from their childhood. So even if people might have written about maybe getting their first bicycle or their first dog, and multiple people may have written about that, it's not the same story. So like those individual units of analysis are clearly nested within persons because people can't share their experiences, at least not in this type of setup. Same thing would be true if we collected eye movements. Those are nested within people, or speech utterances, or anything else that's idiosyncratic like that. It's more ambiguous though when you get into the world of automatic item generation and you're making new items out of blueprints. Then even if you don't have the exact same item, it's built similarly, in which case you would think of them as exchangeable and you wouldn't necessarily need to control for what's left. So this is a thing that I got into earlier in my career when I was trying to learn these things and how they fit together. And I think it's really interesting because they're talked about so differently in different ways that people don't necessarily see how they're connected. So let me show you. Some of you are familiar with IRT models, but most of you said you were either unfamiliar or not that familiar. So I'll just show you a couple things here. This in measurement model land is what's known as either a one-parameter logistic model or a Roche model, which is a person who made this stuff up. And the idea is that the probability of an item response to person P to item I, that's the notation we're doing today here, is one, given theta, is E to, this is thing is theta here, this is person ability, minus B is item difficulty. So theta is a person thing. It's the idea of this latent trait that you have a standing on relative to other people, and it's random in the sense that we're not directly estimating theta per person, What we're estimating directly is the variance across theta, or excuse me, in across people in theta, and we could solve or predict what theta is for each person, but it's not a direct model parameter. In contrast, B here is known as item difficulty. That is being treated as fixed, meaning that each item gets its own. Item one has a number, item two has a number, item three has a number, and so forth. And B has a very specific definition in this context, which is easier to see if you look at the second equation. So I can write this in terms of probability, e to what the model predicts divided by 1 plus e to what the model predicts. That's my inverse link function. Directly, though, if I say the logit of the response of 1, it's just theta minus b. So b is the amount of theta it takes to get to a logit of 0, where these things would cancel out, and that corresponds to a probability of 0.5. So B is the amount of person latent ability it takes to hit a probability of 0.5 and odds of 0, or logit, or excuse me, odds of 1, logit of 0. If I screw that up, I know it's time for a refill, am I right? And if you have something else in your cup, because it's almost 5 o'clock over there, no judgment. But we're starting off with coffee here. So this is a measurement model. Can we agree on that? Sorry, can we say why it's accuracy we were speaking about in IRT? Yes. So what we are modeling in this context is the probability of a response of one. So in an educational context, that would be whether you got the item right as a one. If you were in a psychological setting, it could be whether or not someone endorses having a symptom, or whether they've done something before in terms of like a life events checklist or something like that. So regardless of what the context is, we're predicting the probability that any one response to a particular item from a particular person is one. That help? That helps. Okay, cool. So this is a measurement model, but it's the same thing as a multi-level model. We just write it differently. So I replace the terminology. First thing we're going to do is swap out what we called theta for a random intercept. That is a semantic distinction in this case. Theta is a random intercept. And we switch from minus signs to plus signs, because almost never in linear models would you have minus signs. And we take out the traditional starting point of a linear model of a single general fixed intercept. And instead, we replace it with item-specific intercepts. So these I things here, capital I sub 1, sub 2, and so forth, those are dummy codes. They act like light switches. So if we're in a row of data, this is long data, by the way, where it's one item response per person per row. If I 1 equals 1, then this term turns on, but if I 1 equals 0, then it goes away. So each of these turn on when it's that item's turn in the data set, and these then become item-specific intercepts. So they are then the expected logit of our item response being correct, conditional on theta random intercept being 0. That's the idea of unit specific. It's the same idea that we have here. So because these are plus signs, the interpretation of each of these fixed effects, which I have here as gammas, they become opposite in direction. So they're easiness parameters, meaning higher values mean the item is more likely to be correct, conditional on a theta of 0. So the difference is the direction and the notation, but it's the exact same thing. So you can think of this as a one-parameter measurement model for binary data, or you can think of this as a generalized model for multi-level data, and it's the same. Okay, how we doing? Nodding. Okay. Are you starting to see why I asked you if you knew IRT? Okay, because you do. It turns out I taught you IRT in secret last time. Don't tell anybody. I just used the wrong notation. So, how does this connect to the broader psychometric literature? It has to do with identification. So, here's my model. To identify this model, meaning I have to figure out a scale for my latent variable, it's imaginary, so it doesn't have one. I have to give it to it. On the mean side of the model, I can either fix one item difficulty, one of these b's, to zero, or the sum of the item difficulties to zero, that's more common in some contexts, or the mean of theta. So if I say, okay, this random theta variable here that varies across persons has a mean of zero, on the variance side then, either the variance of theta gets fixed to one, most commonly, or what is not shown here is there's a secret multiplier in front that's called discrimination, and that is implicitly fixed to one if we estimate the variance of theta instead. So the difference in these models comes down to scale. In a traditional multi-level model, what we would have for a random intercept is a mean that's zero, because they're always phrased as deviations from the corresponding fixed intercept. And we have an estimated variance, right? We let the model figure out how much the variance is. Because implicit, that's not shown here, in front of that random intercept is a slope. It's a slope of one. So in psychometric models, you have the option to let items have different slopes relating how they predict the outcome. In these models, we don't. So we don't extend the generalized version to a 2PL, so to speak, that has the slopes because software doesn't do it. But it is technically possible to do that, and I tried to do it in implicit at least. So the difference in these models, they may provide different results because of differences of scale. That's what I'm trying to say. You will not get the same answers back if you have a theta variance fixed to one than if you try to estimate the same model, but then instead estimate the random intercept variance for the people. But you can get back and forth across the two. So the what is it called? The Roche version fixes item discrimination to one, which is what I have here. The 1PL version fixes the theta variance to one instead. Now, what about predictors? One of the things that I learned about in my IRT class from Susan Embredson, I didn't know what a logit was, but I knew what this thing was. There is a model that is abbreviated LLTM. Oh, good, I remembered, I wouldn't remember. Linear Logistic Test Model, that's what that stands for. And the idea of this is that you replace an item-specific difficulty estimate as a fixed effect with some kind of linear model that describes why some items are more difficult than others. So in this case, I would have B now is a function of some intercept for some average item difficulty when the predictors of it are zero, plus whatever effects of these item predictors. We still have a random theta variance in here, but now B is being constructed out of item features. If I write the exact same model as a generalized multi-level model, I put back in the fixed intercept because I have one here. I can add in the same item features, and I can add in my random intercept. That's the same thing as theta. Now, the problem with this model, as noted down here, is that there's no error term. This linear combination explicitly and implicitly here does not have any kind of residual at the end of it. So that means you are saying that you perfectly know why some items are more difficult or more easy than others. Perfectly. And that's unrealistic. So what we need in these kinds of cases, when you're interested in predicting why some items vary in their difficulty or correspondingly their easiness, we need to have an error term. So I have an example. This is actually not the same study I talked about last time, but it's the same kind of task. So we're still detecting changes to otherwise similar feature items that are natural scenes taken from the windshield of a car. We have four different features to the item signs, and we're going to be predicting accuracy instead of response time like this. So what I'm going to show you is that items treated as random matters. What we were missing, do I have it in here? Do I have a slide on that? Yes, I do. I knew it. What we were missing is the random item intercept at the end here. So anytime you're interested in predicting why it is some items are responded to differently than others, they differ in their difficulty or easiness, we need to be able to evaluate to what extent those differences are fully explained by the predictors versus some stuff left over, reasons unknown. So that's where we end up with this model looks exactly the same as what we had last time in terms of cross-random effects of subjects and items at level two. It's just that now we're predicting logits as the outcome. because our response is binary and the probability of a 1 needs to stay bounded. So there you go. You already knew IRT if you know multi-level and vice versa. This is one of those topics, by the way, that I have a really hard time figuring out where it goes in the classes that I teach. Because I teach a class on IRT and SEM. I also teach a separate class, two separate classes on multi-level models, and I stuck it in the latter last time. So it changes periodically, though. But you want to see how this works? Sound good? Okay. Anything you want to ask me about before we change gears and see how it works? Cheers. Let's do it. All right, I was flipping through this to remind me what I have. This is example 3. You should have a PDF version of it linked from the website. Does anyone need that link again? No, we're good. Okay. It is, I put it in the chat. Let me see if I can put it again. Yeah, I can, just in case anyone arrived after I put it in there. Example 3 is linked from the first set of materials on this particular page. This is not an R markdown document. I apologize. I'm still very, very slow at making those, and I had a start of this from a different purpose from that class, so I made it in my usual way. All of the original source files, though, in terms of the data, or not the data, excuse me, the syntax and output are in a download folder. I did not include the data because they're real. So what we're looking at then is variants of what some would call explanatory IRT models. That's the idea that rather than having direct fixed effects that describe differences in item difficulty and potentially discrimination, that we would have a linear predictor of item features that creates those instead, and potentially a linear predictor that predicts differences between subjects, which we'll have. So these are real data. So we're going to be having a random person intercept in all of these models, but then switching out what happens on the item side to show you different variations and how you can think about which one would be work most optimally for you. But I have a total of 5,323 trials, so not complete data in this case, in which either they found the change within the time allotted or they did not. The items are pictures in this case, so you'll see picture ID as the item descriptor. And the items vary themselves in terms of the characteristics of the change that was introduced between two photographs. So again, we show pictures real quick. Yeah, this one right here. So whether or not the change was relevant to driving. So I think we used the same picture last time. Like this sign right here is what differs. It says exit only, so you better be paying attention. Otherwise, you're going to head onto a different road that you didn't want to. And how cluttered the picture is, so just how much stuff there is. The brightness of the change, so that was measured in terms of pixels. It's more of an algorithmic kind of way of measuring it. And then whether or not the change was made to a legible sign. So relevance is binary, clutter and brightness are z-scored continuous variables, and change was binary as well. In terms of subject characteristics, these are older adults. This is from my dissertation data. So we have, in this case, their age, which is continuous in years, as well as a factor score that is a measure of visual impairment that I created out of 5 levels of contrast sensitivity and a measure of far visual acuity. So that should, how well you can see, theoretically, should be related to how well you do on this task. So I'm using R, because you all use R, right? That solidly R folks, a little bit of M plus maybe. Little bit? Okay, I did 1M+, just in case. I didn't know. So I am using, different packages here. Read Excel, teaching demos is what I use to spit out the output from the console a little bit more nicely formatted. Sorting, the psych package for descriptives. We're still using LME4 and Elmer test, but it will be Glimmer, GLMER instead. And then I'm adding in MERT for the IRT examples that are at the end of the electronic materials. So do the usual stuff, define your working directory, import the data. I am selecting for complete cases with respect to all of the predictors that I have here, so that way my sample stays constant across all of the models, no matter what. And here are the predictors and outcome variables that we have and their distributions. So on the whole, Here's accuracy as our first line. It looks like on average, people got 78.3% of these trials correct. And you can see the distributions of the others. So about half the changes were relevant. Clutter has a mean of zero, and so does brightness because they're Z scores, so they're not too far off there. They're meant to be Z scores, but after selection, it's not quite a Z score metric, but close enough. And then whether or not the change was made to a sign, and then age has already been centered at 75, so that the intercept will be a 75-year-old, which was near the mean of the sample. And then visual impairment also is in a factor score, a standardized metric as well. So first thing that we will do, and that I always do, whether I'm teaching or actually analyzing data, is to pretend that I don't need a multi-level model and instead estimate a single-level model with no predictors. So I have written out long form here, the log of the odds, so the log of the probability of a correct answer divided by the probability of an incorrect answer. So the thing in brackets is odds. I take the log of it and it becomes logit. That is being predicted by just a fixed intercept. That's it. So, does anyone have any guesses as to why I would bother to do this? Why would I fit a model that has nothing but a fixed intercept in predicting a binary outcome? To me, this is especially important for our users to know. To see how much variance there is that could be explained, that would be a great answer if this were a continuous outcome. But I know that because it's a binary outcome, there's no single variance. It's instead dependent on the mean, and under a logit, it's always going to be 3.29. But normally, pun intended, normally, under a normal distribution, I might do it that way. What other ideas do you have? Model comparison, that's a good one. I will need to get a log likelihood out of this model to be able to see if adding random effects or fixed effects helps. That's one. That is not what I was thinking, but it is also correct. There's actually a much simpler answer. Let me ask you a yes/no question. Do you find the documentation for R packages uniformly helpful? Or is it kind of hit or miss, depending on who made the package and how thorough they were? That one, right? So, as someone who is new to R, I routinely estimate models in the packages that I know better, SAS and Stata and M Plus, and then I try to fit the same model in R to see if I get the same answers. And if I get the same answers, then I know I've done something right. And if I get the different answers, I know there's something else wrong. So pragmatically, the reason that I would estimate just a fixed intercept in the model is to see whether the package is predicting the probability of a 1 or the probability of a 0. That's why. Because it's not obvious necessarily, and sometimes it depends on the particular instantiation of the model. So particularly for generalized outcomes, so that I can make sure I understand the parameterization of a model, like what metric it's in, which direction it's going, I will start with an empty model. Because this should give me the logit of the probability of a 1, if that's what the model is predicting. It will give me the logit of the probability of a 0, if that's what the model is predicting. So this is using GLM within base R. I have family equals binomial. A binary outcome is a special case of binomial with just one trial, so that's why it's called that. Link equals logit is what I've selected, and then formula correct is the name of my outcome variable, and I just have squiggle one here because all I want is a fixed intercept. So here's what I get back. My fixed intercept is 1.28. Does that number mean anything to you? Nope. What metric is it in? What scale?
A Well, I mean, it's a logit, so yeah,
It's a
it doesn't
logit,
really have a scale for me. It's just like this logit, yeah.
Yep, it's sort of this weird unintuitive scale. I can tell you that if it's a positive number, that means the probability is closer to one than to zero. A negative number would be closer to zero. But yeah, we don't know what this is. So this is in logits. To unlogit it, to put it back into probability, we need an inverse link function. So I usually write it like this: e to the logit over 1 plus e to the logit gives me this number right here, 0.783. That number should match the mean of the outcome if the model is predicting the probability of a 1. I win. That means I know what my software is doing. If it were predicting the probability of a 0 instead, what would this number be? No math required. It's 1.29. If I'm predicting the probability of a 1 for this outcome, what would that number be if I were predicting the probability of a 0?
Would it be a negative?
Negative 1.29. That's it. Logits are symmetric about 0. So if you know what the logit of a 1 response is, you know what a logit of a 0 response is. And I make this point because if you run these models in other software, sometimes this number gives, they give you a threshold instead. A threshold is not an intercept, it's an intercept times minus 1. So a threshold corresponds to the logit of a probability of 0. But if you don't like the version that you got, you can switch it by multiplying by minus 1 or taking the additive inverse, as my more mathematically inclined students would say. So now that I know what this number means, it corresponds to a probability of 0.78, and I did that in R. This is the shorter version of the formula. 1 over 1 plus e to the minus 1 times the fixed intercept that is stored internally. So there's probably a more direct way to ask for that, but I just wrote it out in this case. So then here's the number and probability that we get. So let's turn this into the multi-level model that it should be, at least in part, by adding in random persons. And I will apologize. It's TPI for the subscripts structure this time. It was TIP last time. I already had this as TPI, but really it doesn't matter because as long as you're internally consistent in your ordering, then it should be fine. We are going to end up with persons and items crossed at level 2, so it doesn't really matter which comes first. I will keep T as the index for which trial it is at level 1 because that is lower, so I put that one first as a habit. So if I add in a random intercept, otherwise known as theta in this context, how many new parameters have I added to my model? No math required. No counting required. How many new parameters by adding in a random person intercept, or otherwise known as personability or theta? I can see people typing, I think, waiting with bated breath, as they say. I really wish Zoom had the three dots, like in text messages, so you could see when someone's typing and wait. That'd be nice. One parameter, ding, 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 that is correct. You added one variance, one thing. So it doesn't matter how many people there are, one thing, because people are treated as random. We are not estimating a separate theta per person, we're estimating the variance across people in their thetas with a mean of 0. So to switch then to multi-level modeling functions, I'm using what is called GLMER. I'm pretty sure whoever wrote this meant G Elmer as the way it should be pronounced, like generalized Elmer, but to me it looks like glimmer. So that's what I say, it's glimmer. Like, I have a glimmer of hope that I can make this model estimate. That's what I think it means. So we are switching to that. The family part stays the same. I'm adding in an estimation option, which is the number of quadrature points. This turns the estimation algorithm into something called Laplace. Don't understand it all that well, but what I know is that if you add additional random effects or random slopes, it changes to this. So I'm starting with that the whole time to keep it consistent. I am modeling correct responses as the outcome with a fixed intercept, and then the thing in parentheses here is the random intercept variance across people. So this is the U for the P's in this case. Asking then for minus 2 times the log likelihood with more precision, summary, and then an interclass correlation. So yes, we can then compare against the previous model this way if we needed to, which we'll do, I think, in just a minute. So we have one new parameter here. And what's not in the table of variances that would normally be there? Normally, pun intended. What are we missing from this table that would normally be here? Yeah, residual variance. It's 3.29 no matter what you do, because we're in logits. So the variance across people, it was estimated at 0.25. Is that a lot? Is that good? It's even harder to make that decision in this metric, in the logit metric, which is what we're in. So we will ask the question a different way. What would the intraclass correlation be? Well, in these models, we would put the person random intercept variance in the numerator and in the denominator as usual, and where estimated residual variance would go, we throw in 3.29. So this is an intraclass correlation in logits. I think you can think of it as the amount relative to the total variance. It's the proportion of variance that's due to between person differences in ability, or how accurate they tend to be overall. One's propensity to be accurate, you can think of it that way. And in this data set, it's only 7%, so not a lot of variability across subjects relative to across items or their residual. So this performance package that generated this ICC, that's where that number came from. It's by plugging in 3.29 where the estimated residual variance would have been. It's 3.29 in logits or 1 in probits. The fixed intercept has moved around a little bit. It was 1.29 and now it's 1.35. It's changed interpretation. So this is now the predicted logit for a correct response, conditional on someone with a random theta intercept of 0. So it's unit specific in that case. If we want to know if we need that random person variance, if 7% is significantly greater than 0, we can do our model comparison. And in this case, Renova, which is the one that I had been using with Elmer, doesn't work, but regular flavor ANOVA does. So this is asking for a likelihood ratio test. It has nothing to do with analysis of variance, but we still call it that. The model that has more parameters goes first, and the model that has fewer parameters goes second. And so this value right here is your test statistic for the difference in minus 2 log likelihood between these models after adding one person variance. And it's significant to, like 16 decimal places. So yeah, we'll keep it. And if I want to convert that fixed intercept to probability, I can do that, and that corresponds to a slightly higher probability. So then the average predicted probability of a 1 is 0.79 from this model because that's specifically for somebody of medium mean ability. How are we doing? Okay, so far? Oh, almost to the top, not quite. I'm guessing that's because it's like 5:42 over there, right? 4:42? What time is it? 4:42. Okay, yeah. End of the workday. So let's turn this into a measurement model. I'm going to estimate a Roche model using Glimmer. So the model itself replaces the fixed intercept that is one value with item-specific intercepts. So items are pictures here. So I have a fixed intercept for picture one, one for picture two, all the way up to whatever it would be for picture 36. And now I'm realizing I need to have that in there. My bad. I will fix that afterwards, along with any other typos I find along the way. So the code to do this looks the same for this part, and instead of having a general intercept, we're shutting it off with the zero. So I am shutting off the expected fixed intercept that would apply to all the rows and exchanging it for an item-specific version that applies only to the rows for that item. So to do that, I'm taking the ID variable that I have that distinguishes which item or picture is which, treating it as a factor. So that is essentially taking the 36 pictures and turning them into 36 dummy codes, one for each, without having to do any of that coding. So the as factor accomplishes this part of it. The zero in front shuts off the general intercept that does not have a picture multiplier before it, and we keep the person intercept. I then computed predicted probabilities for the entire set of results by asking for the fixed effects from that model, which are the item-specific easiness parameters, and then using the inverse link function 1 over 1 plus e to the 1 times minus 1 times that to be the probability. So a couple of things of note here. Here are my results. These are not difficulty parameters, they are easiness parameters. So they tell you what the predicted logit is of a correct response for somebody with a random intercept of 0 or a theta of 0, either way. If I wanted to make them difficulties instead, what would I need to do? If reviewer three is like, I don't want an easiness parameter, I want a difficulty parameter. Please tell me the logit of the probability of a 1. How do I make them tell me the logit of the probability of a 0? I don't even have to compute it. No math required. Yep, take the negative. Yep, times minus 1. So in a model in which the slopes, the implicit slopes that are written here, they're like whatever's this should have something in front of it, essentially. When that something is 1, you can directly interpret difficulties as the opposite of easinesses in terms of like the traditional IRT difficulty value. That goes away once you have a different slope, but it holds in this particular case. So yeah, if I wanted to turn these into traditional IRT difficulty parameters, I take minus 1 times each of those and I'm good to go. Now, the other thing I wanted to point out, person variance is higher now. Person variance used to be 0.25 and now it's 0.37. That looks weird until you remember that the model has changed scale. Because what we have done by adding in all of these picture-specific dummy codes is explain what is currently residual variability at level one. Anytime you explain level one variance, it can't go down from 3.29, it has to stay put. So that means the other variances in the model have to grow to compensate. So we have what looks like more person variance in order to still have 3.29 as the logit version of residual variance in this model. So things change scale as you explain level one, just don't forget that. Does it help? Well, we can also do likelihood ratio tests for differences in fixed effects. So if I compare this model with all 36 easiness parameters to the nested model that had only one fixed intercept, another way of saying that is that I'm asking, do I need 36 versions of the intercept or can I get by with one? Are items equivalent in their easiness or does each need their own? So the difference between one easiness as a fixed intercept and 36 item-specific versions is the degrees of freedom 35. And so this difference in minus 2 log likelihood between models, which is significant to 16 decimal places, tells us that yeah, items differ in their easiness. So there is something going on here that makes some items tougher to solve than others. And the question is what? In this model, we can't know what, right? All we know is that, for instance, Picture 129 is a lot easier than picture 155. But there's nothing in here that gives me like why is that the case? There's nothing that would allow me to test a hypothesis about that because every item already gets its own stuff. So said differently, this model is assuming that item responses are nested within persons because we've already controlled for all the reasons why some items are more difficult or easier than others. If we want to predict those differences, that's where we switch to the idea of a random item intercept instead of a fixed item intercept. So this is another way of asking the same question, to what extent do items differ in their easiness? And equivalently, their difficulty in this case. But adding a variance across items in their difficulty then allows us to quantify and predict why some items are more difficult than others. So this would be considered the baseline of what will be an explanatory IRT model in one more take. So we take out all of the picture-specific dummy codes as fixed effects. We put back in the single fixed intercept, and we add in another random intercept variance for item differences across the pictures in how easily they are found, essentially, in their correctness. So let me ask you this. Relative to model two that had this much, how many new parameters have I added by adding that piece? Relative to a model with just random people, how many parameters have I added by just allowing the items to be random? No math required. Your question. How many new parameters by allowing a random item effect beyond just a random person effect? Well, when we added random people, it was one, right? So if we add random items, just one. Yeah, one variance. Items and people are not correlated in these models. So by putting the random effects in separate parentheses like that, you're introducing them as like separate types of variability that do not have covariances among them. When you put something inside the same parentheses with the one, then you're introducing a correlation between those two random effects. So these are like two separate level two sets of units. So here's our two variances right now. Variance across people is still 0.36. That's very similar to what it was in the model where items are fixed effects because we've isolated the variability due to items either way. But now we have a variance across items of 0.99. So just eyeballing these two numbers, it looks like more. I can ask for intra-class correlations for each of these relatives to the total. And the intra-class correlation for pictures is 0.2. So 21% of the variability in correct responses is because some items are easier than others. About 8% is because some people are better at this than others. And the rest of it is, I don't know why, something about some specific combination of that trial for that person. Do items need to be random? Is that 21% different than zero? Absolutely, it is. There's another likelihood ratio test for that. And I have a note that you can cut the p-value in half if you want to report a mixture chi-square result instead. I have that in the results section that goes with it. And I'm saving the variances across subjects and items for use in computing re variance reductions and as effect size measures in subsequent models. So there we go. Want to see the next one? Next step then, find out why some items are easier than others. So I'm building in a linear predictor that has the four features that I deliberately varied across these items. So how cluttered the item is as a continuous measure, whether the change was relevant to driving as a binary one, how bright the change was as a continuous measure, and whether the change was made to a legible sign. So each of these fixed effects has a number in the last spot because that's where I is in the notation, so TPI. And each of these variables only has an I after it because it only varies across items. Doesn't vary across people or trials, it doesn't need those letters. So building my linear predictor then with these things, leaving in my person random variance, so theta variance as you might call it, and also the idea of variance left over across pictures. So this random intercept variance for pictures right here, this is the idea of a residual to this linear predictor. After I control for these four things, how much variability have I explained in item easiness and how much is left over? This is allowing me to answer that question. So in the results then, we see the variability across pictures. Okay, that's got to be a typo. I think I pasted in the same number twice for this one. I will fix that later. It should be reduced to something, but not quite, not the exact same number. Fixed effects, we go down here. Fixed intercept in this case is now for the reference item. So 1.37 is the expected logit of a correct response for a picture at zero levels of clutter that's not relevant to driving, that's not, the change is not to assign, and at zero levels of brightness. From there, what happens if you're looking at a picture with a lot of clutter in it? Does your logit go up or down? This is a minus sign here. If the picture is more cluttered, what happens to your logit? Up or down? So you are more likely to get it right or less likely? Likely? Less likely. Yeah, I kind of feel like I'm dancing here. Dancing for your entertainment at 5 in the afternoon or so. Yeah, less likely. So even though these are weird, like if I wanted to actually interpret this number, I'd say for every additional unit of clutter, the logit of a correct response goes down by 0.33. If I wanted to say that more directly, I'd be like, the more cluttered it is, the lower your probability of getting it right. The end. Relevance. If the change is made to, if the change was relevant to driving, you were slightly more logity. Can I say that? More logity to get it right? More likely? More probable? I think logity. I'm gonna go with that one today. If the change is more obvious, if it takes up more pixels of the screen, you are more logity to get it right, 0.83 in logits per unit brightness. And if the change is made to a legible sign, you are also more likely to get it right. However, if we go over to the p-value column. Clutter, not uniquely significant. Relevance, not uniquely significant. The only one that is the sign one. So it could be because these predictor features are correlated, because each of these is the unique effect after controlling for the others. So to get a sense overall of how well the model is working at predicting item easiness, we would want to know how much variability has been explained. So I computed that next. So I saved the previous results where we had all of the random item differences unexplained as model 4. Then I saved the results from model 5. So this is the same technique that I demonstrated last time, in which you save that piece of output as a data frame, and then you can access its rows and columns for the particular values you want to save. And then I'm computing a subject random intercept R square and an item random intercept R square. So each of these is computed the same way. Space that over. What it was minus what it is over what it was. So for subjects, I've explained basically zero variance, and for items, I've explained about 25% of it. Surprising or unsurprising? Let's do faces this time. We'll break it up. Surprising? Unsurprising? How's that? Yep, so you're making the 5 o'clock unsurprising face. That is correct. Yeah, we didn't put in any subject predictors. So why would the subject variability change? We put in item predictors, and we reduced the item variability in the random intercept by 25%. So then the question is that enough, or is there variance left over? And what would happen if we pretended that we didn't have variance left over? If we fit the LLTM as originally specified in 1973, and as what I was taught in around the year 2000? How would we answer that question? Do we need random item variance left over? How can I answer that? Give you a hint, model comparison of some kind. Or you can flip to the next page on your handout, your call.
If you compare it to model variability about the residual variance.
Yeah, we'll take the random intercept variance left over out and see if it hurts. So let's do it. Everything looks the same except for the end where we had random item variance is gone. So, to answer the question, here's my model comparison. The result is significant. So, does that mean that we should have kept it or we're okay to get rid of it? Should have kept it, yeah. So, anytime you have a significant model comparison like this, you can think of it in two equivalent ways. The model with more stuff in it fits significantly better, or the model with less stuff in it fits significantly worse. Either way is correct here. The way that I approached it is the latter. If I have a model with the random intercept across items, the other 75% of the variance compared to a model when I take it away, the takeaway model fits worse. So we keep it. So, in terms of why it would matter, let me compare the results from the previous model, which I have stuck here in this little box for us because I knew I was going to do that, to these results. The estimates are fairly similar. They're not that close, but they're at least in the same directions. But look at the p-values. Previously, I had 3 out of 4 fixed effects be non-significant, and if I come down here, all of them are significant to many decimal places. The standard errors are quite different. They're much larger in the model that has the random item intercept variance left over relative to the model without it. So, this is practically speaking why we would care. If you pretend that your items are perfectly predicted by your item features, by not having random item variance left over as its residual, then your hypothesis tests are likely to be incorrect because the standard errors are going to be too small, therefore your p-values will be too small. Sorry about that. And this is the type of mistake that I made in doing my dissertation data analysis, because this is how I learned how to do it from an LLTM perspective as opposed to a mixed model perspective in which items can be random. So we don't want to do that. In terms of how the item predictions would work, I put together a little comparison across the models that we've examined thus far. So, model 3 was a Roche model in which items were fixed. So, I saved the estimates of item easiness out of that model directly. Model 4 was an empty model in which all items got their own random intercept. Since a random intercept has a mean of 0, I need to add the fixed intercept back in to get to the overall easiness. So, I did that by saving the random effects out of model 4, which was the crossed empty model, and then adding in the fixed intercept back into that. Model 6 predicted the items but treated them as fixed by not having a random intercept. So I used the predict function to get predicted outcomes from that model. I did the same thing in model 5, which had a random intercept in the model, but I didn't include it in the prediction. I then combined those predictions and printed the correlation matrix among them. So, this is what I wanted to show you. First off, if I have a Roche model in which each item gets its own fixed intercept versus a crossed random effects model in which each item gets its own random effect within a random intercept variance, and I ask for those predicted outcomes for either model, they're nearly the same. So whether you treat items as fixed or random, like what you would estimate for each item in terms of its difficulty or easiness is going to be pretty similar. However, if I compare the predictions of a Roche model as the right answer for what each item should be, and correlate that with the predictions just using these four features, that correlation is only 0.47, which works out to a correlation squared of 0.23. Similarly, if I take the random item easinesses as the right answer and compare them to what would be predicted from the four features, I get a very similar result with a similar level of squared correlation. So these numbers are very close to the amount of variance that was explained in the random intercept, and that was how I had learned to compute them back in the day. So the point of the story is the predicted item easiness is not going to match what it would be in the Roche model unless you perfectly predicted it, and that's not going to be the case, which is why we need to keep track of random items. Okay, how are we doing? Hanging in there? I think we have maybe two more models, maybe three. Do we have strength for enough for maybe two more? They're like, oh, the end is in sight. There's nothing worse than like being somewhere and waiting when you don't know how long the wait is going to be. Like when the airline pilot comes on and says, "We've got a little delay here, folks. We'll be getting on our way just as soon as we can." Like that's somewhere between 5 minutes and the rest of my life. Like I don't handle those situations very well, but I'm telling you, come hell or high water, we will be done at 10:30, probably before. Or 5:30 for you. Come hell or high water is, I think, a Midwestern expression, but we have a lot of flooding right now, so it's apropos. Hell is high water for most people. So what about subjects? They haven't been part of the story. The nice thing about these cross random effects models or explanatory item response models is that you can have subject predictors too. So let's do that. Maybe people who are older are less good at this task, and maybe people who have more visual impairment are less good at this task. Could be. So we can throw in those predictors into our. Darn it, here's another typo. That should not be there. I had one more earlier and I decided to simplify. Again, I will post the right version of this when I'm done. We can throw in these two, see what happens. So the two new ones here. Now, this fixed intercept is conditional on all of the item features being zero. It's also specifically for a person who is 75 and has average levels of visual impairment. That is their predicted logit of a correct response, also conditional on an average item and an average person. So it's conditional on everything in the model, every fixed and every random effect. Here are our same four item features. Similar results and inference as before, only signs matter with respect to predicting accuracy if you control for random item differences, which we needed to do. And here's the new ones. Okay, what happens to the logit of a correct response if you are older? Up or down? Down. What happens to the logit of a correct response if you are more impaired visually, which is what this variable means? Down. And what if reviewer three wanted me to predict the logit of an incorrect response? Do I need to rerun my model? Nope. What do I do? I want to predict the probability of a zero instead of the probability of a one. Yep, multiply by minus one. They're symmetric. Now, where these models get really confusing at times is when all of these slopes are predicting the probability of a one, but the intercept itself is given in a threshold metric which refers to the probability of a zero. That is what M plus does to you, for instance, and other packages. I tend to override those defaults whenever I possibly can, but you will see them much more commonly in ordinal models than binary. So you get thresholds. You will know what you get if you start with an empty model and see if it matches the probability of a zero or a probability of a one. Then you'll know. But the rest of these almost uniformly will predict the probability of a one. Which of my three variances should I have now reduced? Level one residual, people variance, or item variance? By adding in age and visual impairment, did I reduce people variance, item variance, or trial variance? Two votes for people, people have it, yeah. So if we do pseudo R square for that, now relative to the empty model on both sides, model four, I've explained about 23% of the people variance and still explained around 25% of the item variance. So that story has not changed. How are we doing? So here's some extra stuff that you can think about in this framework that is not part of the IRT world, as far as I know. This model assumes that people differ from each other in only one way. Another way of saying it is that it's a unidimensional IRT model in the sense that people differ in ability and that's it, and how they differ in ability is constant no matter what item it is. But what if some people are more messed up by some of these features than others? What if people who have worse vision, for instance, do especially worse on highly cluttered pictures? Could that happen? Sure. Could some people be more susceptible to item manipulations or differences than other people? Yeah, that seems reasonable. So how do I operationalize that idea? If the effect of an item predictor might differ across people, what does that sound like? Interactions, yeah. So if I wanted to have, for instance, clutter by age or clutter by visual impairment, I could. What kind of variance would it predict though? Missing something that would go along with that idea of an interaction. Two-word phrase, first word is random. Random slope in this case. If I didn't have the random slope, it would explain residual variance. That is correct. But random slope is also the idea of unexplained differences. If I just put in the cross-level interaction, say between vision and clutter, that's saying that all the reasons why some people are more susceptible to clutter is because of visual impairment, and that's it. A random slope is reasons left over. So it's the idea of unexplained differences across people in their reaction to visual clutter. It would be consistent with a type of multidimensional IRT model because now there's two ways that people would differ from each other. So to do something like that, I ended up picking a brightness for this example because I thought that one would be most relevant. No pun intended on that one. So I added in bright right here. So note, this is something that's very easy to screw up in code. The variable the slope is for, it goes in the other set of brackets relative to what it's measured. So brightness is an item thing. Its slope goes in the person brackets. So person random effects here gets an intercept, and this would allow a slope of item brightness across people. So now if we do that, we pick up two new parameters, the slope variance and its correlation with the person random intercept. Survey says, in terms of test statistic, make that bigger, on those 2 degrees of freedom, we have a non-significant result. And in case reviewer three is like, you should have used a mixture chi-square. Okay, fine. If I use a mixture of degrees of freedom one and two, that means that I combine the two p-values from those equally weighted half and half, and I end up with a still non-significant p-value that would be more correct, but still the same idea. So according to this, no, people don't need their own slope of brightness. I tried the other three predictors and the same result was there. Now, last thing. What about the other way? We're all psychologists, right? Or social scientists who care about people and items are just a way to get there? What if you were somebody who cared about items? And you don't care about your people? We could go the other way. What if differences across people matter more for some items? Like age has a bigger impact on some items than others in terms of predicting that item's performance. Could that happen? Yeah. Do you know what that one's called? Two-word phrase. First word is random. Still random slopes, just going the other way. So these crossed models have the opportunity to ask whether there is a random slope over the other dimension both ways. Yeah, random slopes for the items instead of the people. Exactly right. So I could add in a random slope for item I that goes with age, for instance. And I could ask whether the effect of age depends on which item you're looking at. The way that I would do it is the exact opposite of what I did before, because age is a person thing, it goes in the picture set of brackets. Whereas item things would go in the person set of brackets, and I did not keep the other random slope since the model said we didn't need it. Model comparison, survey says nope. Doesn't look like there's any evidence that the effect of age depends on which item you're looking at. But either way, if either of these random slopes had been significant or sizable enough to keep, we would then look at cross-level interactions to explain them. And if you had both in the model at once, which one would it get explained? I think is something I'm not entirely sure. I think they would both go down to some extent, but this is an area of research that I'm interested in pursuing. So if I find out anything more, I'll let you know. But just keep it as what do you call it, placeholder in your mind that random slopes can work both ways. The effect of item things can differ across people. The effect of people things can differ across items. And interactions of people characteristics by item characteristics are what would explain it either way. And look, here's some words. So this would be the language I would describe these models and the model comparisons as part of this handout. Ta-da! Yay! Do you know what this means in sign language? This is my version of my 6-month-old teaching me sign language. This means all done. I know, please, thank you, and all done. That's it. So that's the end. For those of you who use M plus, I was able to build an example of, I think it's model 5 in there. Let me see. It's in the example 3 download. No, model 7, excuse me, in that one. I can open that real quick and show you what that would look like. Let me see if I can make it bigger. Nope, not that one. Zoom, there we go. Okay, so this is a cross-classified example where we don't have anything in the within model. We have a between model that has people's characteristics in it. So this is where like age and visual impairment would go. And then we have a between model for the pictures. And this is where the four features would go. M plus currently does not allow us to have random slopes of one level two over the other, but I suspect that would be coming momentarily. But this is what it would look like in this framework in which you could also add in other latent variables. You could add in, let's see, path modeling, like more extensive models and stuff like that. So if you're interested in taking like this idea of explanatory IRT and embedding it in a more complex model, this would be the type of setup I would recommend, either this or STAM. M plus is supposed to have ways of estimating random discrimination as well. So, like, essentially, the multiplier that would be in front of theta, rather than setting that to one, you could make that a random variable and predict why some items are more discriminating. I could not get that to work. It kept throwing me error messages, and so I had to give up. But theoretically, I know that that is possible as well. So, that output is in your folder as well if you want to take a look at that. All right. Any questions on any of that? Well, since one of you thought this meant applause, how about we clap it out and say, yay, we're done for today. Yay. No, really, we can clap it out. Clap it out. All right, then the plan for next time, which is in 2 weeks. Two of you said that you wanted to talk about your data specifically, and I think only one person mentioned their name because I stupidly forgot to ask that question. Like, who am I? Who is filling out the survey? So it'll be a surprise. It'll be a surprise to the rest of us, but hopefully you know what you said. Two people wanted to talk about their data. Go ahead.
No, I was going to say, I think I was the one who said yes, but not their name.
Tian was one and said, hi, this is Tian. And then, so yes, so Charlotta, well, so both of you will be able to talk as much as you want about your data. And when I mean talk or present, like, you don't have to go to the trouble to make a PowerPoint or anything. Like, if you want to just talk with words, or if you have a diagram or something you made for something else you want to show, if that's helpful, that's fine. I think two or three other folks said they had specific questions, but they didn't necessarily want to present at that type of level. We can talk about that. And everyone else who filled out the survey just said they wanted to listen. So we'll reconvene in 2 weeks. We'll talk about stuff. I would say that your questions do not have to be confined to this topic. If there's anything that I can help you with in the world of quantitative methods, I will do my best to try. And if I can't help you, I'll just tell you that and see if I can find you some other resources. So whatever would be useful for your time is what I want to do, okay? Yes. And Anna says we'd like to do presenting. Yeah, I think it's really helpful to hear what other folks are doing because it usually has some similarity to what you're doing and otherwise can inspire you to add something that you might not have thought of. So I think these sorts of discussions can be informative for the participants as well as the actual active presenters. All right, then I will see you in 2 weeks. I will send out the list of resources that I had compiled from last time. I didn't add any today, I don't think, but if you think of anything else you want, please send me an email and I'll be happy to send it along. Okay? All right, enjoy the rest of your Tuesday. Happy garbage day. I'll see you in a garbage day in 2 weeks, okay? All right, bye for now. Tschüss.
Bye, cheese.
Juice.
Bye, thank you.
Thank you. Bye.